So everything you need to know about cars in one video. Let's see how we can do this. So we're thinking particularly about car enthusiasts, people that are looking to improve their car or just generally look after their car. This is very much a beginner's guide. We're not going to go into the complexities. If you're interested in any of the topics that I've mentioned here, I've done other videos that go into much more detail on these topics. So be sure to explore those other videos. But we're just going to help you to grapple with the terminology. Now, often when people go onto forums, clubs, or talk to enthusiasts, there's often a bit of snobbery there. People don't like these newbies, these newcomers with the silly question. But we've all asked those silly questions at one point. This video really is aimed at explaining those silly questions to give you a decent basis, a decent grounding in the world of cars and car modification. So we're going to explore engines, drivetrains, brakes, suspension, handling and performance modifications. And we're also going to look at one mod that really ties everything together. If you forget this one thing, you're really going to suffer in terms of the performance output of your car. But first up, as a driver, you have a responsibility to look after your car. So there are a few things that you as a driver should just be aware of when driving a car. And these things all guarantee that the car is reliable and you maintain that reliability over your car ownership. So warm up the engine before you drive it hard. Allow the engine to warm up. At the end of a drive, allow it to cool down a little bit just before you turn the engine off. Those simple things will extend the life of every engine. Some are more demanding that you do that, and others are certainly less tolerant. And I know a lot of drivers out there just don't care about the warm-up cycles. But it is an important factor on pretty much every car I've ever owned or driven, and you want to warm it up gently before you drive it hard. Change the oil often. The single biggest thing that kills cars, in my opinion, is the lack of oil changes and the infrequent servicing that goes on. A lot of the engine wear that goes on is just because the oil has been allowed to degrade and excessive wear has happened in the engine. So if you're only planning to keep the car for a year or two, it doesn't matter. Someone else is going to foot the bill. But if you want to keep the car as long as possible, change the oil. Now, if the manufacturer says 12 months, 9,000 miles, you might want to shorten that to 7 months, 6,000 miles. Certainly, the manufacturers are erring on the side of caution, but they don't want to make their cars look expensive to run. So they push the servicing schedules as far away as they can. And that gives people a false sense of security. It's a relatively minor cost just getting the service done. But by doing that, you really can extend the life of the car significantly. Be sure to check the car regularly. You're checking the fluid levels inside the engine bay, so certainly find out how to do that. You want to keep an eye on the coolant, the oil levels particularly, and just keep an eye on the brake fluid levels as well. That's just a bit of a safety thing. And checking the tire pressures can guarantee that those tires last as long as you would expect them to, and you're getting the fuel economy that you expect from that car, because underinflated tires will really soak up your fuel economy significantly. Use good quality fuel. Now, I'm not talking about octane. A lot of people have this conception that all fuels are the same. They're not. A lot of the branded fuels have a completely different set of additives to the unbranded fuels that you may buy at, say, a supermarket. So there's obviously exceptions. They are all different. You can't just make a rule here that branded fuels are best, because sometimes a branded fuel may not be. I personally prefer Shell, the V-Power range. I find the additives in that very, very effective at keeping everything inside the engine clean. I've not been paid to say that, but it really does pay to use a good quality fuel formulation with a decent additive pack, and that'll go a long way to maintaining the lifespan of your car. And another thing, don't be afraid to exploit the full RPM range. You're not actually going to help the car by grannying it everywhere. A lot of car problems happen because people don't exceed the bottom third of the RPM range. So maybe you don't want to do it all the time, but doing it infrequently, overtaking a car, actually enjoying the car, using the upper part of the RPM range when the engine is warm, will go a long way to keeping everything ticking over nicely, to give the tubes inside a good old clear out, a good old blow through. And you'll avoid a lot of the problems that people experience with the clogging, the carbon buildup, the particulate filter issues that crop up when a car has been driven very carefully all the time. So understanding the car engine is essentially an air pump. It's really good at drawing air in. It will match the air requirement with fuel. It will burn that fuel and then it will spit it out through the exhaust. So it's very much pumping air. So most of the modifications that you do will be looking to improve the engine's ability to pump air. And the more air you can get into the engine, the more fuel you can burn. So the air to fuel ratio is very, very important in an engine. In a gasoline or petrol powered car, it's much, much more demanding in terms of the air to fuel ratio. The air to fuel ratio of your gasoline or petrol car is 14.7 to 1. You don't want to vary that too much. So that's 14.7 parts of air to one part fuel. And that ratio, it's a magic ratio, and it guarantees that you get the maximum amount of power and the maximum amount of economy. You're not wasting fuel. You're not producing harmful emissions from the engine at that ratio. So going down to 12.5 to 1, we would call that a rich mixture. You've got more fuel going in to the ratio. The air ratio has come down. So that typically produces more power. You're using more fuel in relation to the air that's going into the engine. A rich mixture actually burns cooler. You've got less chance of knock happening in the combustion chamber, which is where the fuel inside the combustion chamber doesn't ignite at the point you want it to. It's got an uneven burn going on. It makes a significant knocking noise and can cause damage. A lean mixture may go from 16 to 1, and that improves fuel economy and emissions. You're using less fuel in relation to the air, but engine temperatures are increased. The risk of knock is also increased inside the engine. So the computer inside the engine is doing a lot to maintain the air to fuel mixture. If you've got alternative fuel types, it's completely different in terms of the ratios. So your diesel fuel, for example, is around 14.5 to 1, but the variance is much, much wider. It can be 18 to 1, right up to 70 to 1. Yes, diesel engines can really run at those extremes. So the way the fuel burns in a diesel engine is very different. In a petrol or gasoline engine, you have a spark that ignites the fuel. In a diesel engine, it's the heat from the compression. As the fuel goes into the engine at that last moment, it spontaneously ignites. So it's much more effective at extracting power from the fuel in relation to some of the other fuel types, which is why the diesel engines are generally more economical and more torquey. So in terms of performance tuning, adjusting those ratios of air to fuel is one of the significant things that can be done. There's lots of other factors involved, but generally inside the computer, if you get the car to burn less or more fuel in relation to air, you'll have better fuel economy or better performance and power. The engine itself is divided into two parts. You've got the top end of the engine, which you would call the head. That is where the valves are that allow the air into the engine, and the exhaust valves allow the gases to come out of the engine. So the head does a lot of work to control the airflow in and out of the engine. The bottom end of the engine, you've got the cylinders where the combustion process goes on. You've got the crank, the pistons. The pistons are pushed down when the engine is combusting or burning the fuel, and they will rotate the crank. And as the crank rotates, it's creating drive, and that goes out to the wheels and propels the car along. So increasing the capacity of the engine, reboring it, making the cylinders bigger, changing the stroke so the pistons travel a different amount of distance, maybe even the pistons are a different height. That adjusts the overall capacity of air that the engine can draw in and can have an impact on the performance and the power output of the engine. So those mods very much affect the car's ability to act as an air pump. You can draw more air in, you can burn more fuel. So as you can imagine, with burning fuel in the internal combustion engine, you're generating a lot of heat, and that heat needs to be dealt with. Heat really is the enemy of the car's long-term reliability. So your head, the gaskets, and other components inside the engine are subject to contraction and expansion depending on those heat cycles. So if they get too hot, these components can actually start to fail over time. So having decent cooling on the car car is certainly a significant step. So water is circulated around the engine. There's a little pump that drives this circuit of water around. That water then goes to a radiator at the front of the car where cool air is coming in. And that helps to cool down the water that is circulating around the engine. So you're moving the heat from inside the engine to the radiator and then dissipating that heat as the car drives through the air. So a lot of people think about brake upgrades. Now, don't pay too much attention to brake upgrades. A brake upgrade typically just means you're going to be able to stop faster for more stops than you would on the stock setup. It doesn't dramatically reduce your stopping distance. The grip is the biggest factor here, but people upgrade the braking system to tolerate more heat. The braking system can work effectively for longer periods of time in more extreme conditions. So changing the size of the brake disc or brake rotor, so depending on where you're living, you'll have a different name for a lot of these items, but that's essentially the big metal disc that's inside the wheel, and that is what the brake pads press against. Now, the thing that's pressing those brake pads against that rotor or that disc is the piston. So you might have heard the term a four-pot caliper. That is basically four pistons clamping the pads against the rotor. You can get six-pot brake setups. There's various different configurations. The rears tend to be just one pot. So looking at the brake caliper itself, you can generally see how many pots there are. There'll be a large circle on the actual caliper, and you just double what you can see. So on the outside of the wheel, if you've got two pots, it's going to be a four-pot brake system. So people often talk about suspension components. You've got coilovers. So that's effectively your suspension system with the coil or the spring at the top, and they're generally adjustable. So you can change the height of the car quite easily. They're not that much different from the stock factory ones, except for the fact that they are adjustable. There's a bit of variation there in terms of how the spring is pre-compressed. You might have heard the expression air suspension, or running on air, or running on bags. So this is where there's a layer of air between the car and the top of the suspension mount. So by adjusting the amount of air, you change the ride height of the car. They are generally more comfortable to drive when you're driving on air. There's less vibration that comes through the car's body into the cabin itself. But the handling is somewhat compromised. It's a little more floaty and woolly compared to the other suspension setup. You've got various suspension designs. You've got the McPherson and various other link systems. So we won't go into the complexities of all of those. You're generally stuck with whatever the manufacturer of your car has decided. You wouldn't be looking to change the suspension design because that's a significant modification. But just changing the ride height. And when you go around a corner, you've noticed that the car tends to sway, it tends to roll. So eliminating that roll is certainly an aim of improving the performance. And you would do that with a sway bar or anti-roll bar that effectively links both sides of the car. So if one side tends to lift up, it pulls it down. It just keeps everything aligned nicely. So that's a relatively simple modification that can make quite a difference to some cars' handling. You've got tower braces or strut braces that go at the top of the suspension and tie that together. So it's arguable as to whether that makes much of a difference. On older cars, those suspension turrets have actually started to move a little. So it helps to realign those, and it certainly keeps everything nice and tight. So again, depending on the design of the car, we'll determine whether you actually need to do these tower braces or these strut braces as well. But with suspension, you want to keep things straight, relatively tight. You don't want it too firm. You want to keep the wheels in contact with the road at all times. So the popular mods that people do are the intakes and the exhaust. So the intake, the theory behind that is it allows more air into the engine, and exhaust mods allow more air out of the engine. Now, think about velocity. Velocity is absolutely vital. You don't want to slow up the flow of air. You want the heat pump to be as effective as possible. And if you've got large pipes, large bore sizes, they actually flow more slowly, and you can damage the performance of an engine if you go too large. Now, in the exhaust, you've effectively got little pulses of gas coming out of the engine with each stroke. And as they shoot up the exhaust, they create a little vacuum behind them. That vacuum actually helps to empty the cylinder of those exhaust gases. So if those exhaust gases are flowing too slowly, you lose that effect. The cylinders don't empty as effectively. So when the new charge of air goes into the engine, it's got less space to fill the sum of those exhaust gases left behind. So it's a common mistake that we often see, people going too large on the exhaust or too large on the intake. And what effectively has happened is they've slowed up the velocity of air at their typical RPM range of driving. So if you spend most of your time at high RPMs in a, say, motorsport environment, the velocity at the top end is more important and you can get away with those larger bore sizes. If you want to use your car on the road and you're driving in traffic, you want the power fairly low down and accessible at all times. The ECU, the engine control computer, the dynamic motor control, the electronic management system, I think every manufacturer have got their own name for it, but basically there is a computer inside the engine that controls everything the engine's doing. If it's got a turbocharger, it may well be controlling the amount of air that comes from the turbo into the engine. But essentially, it's controlling the flow of air and fuel, the way the fuel is burned, and also the rate at which the engine is working and producing power, depending on what you as a driver are doing with the throttle pedal. So changing the parameters that that works to will make a significant difference on the engine's output and the engine's power. So we would refer to that as tuning the engine or remapping, where you change the map inside that computer. So the map is basically a table that the computer uses to look up what to do, how much fuel for any given amount of air coming into the engine. And there are sensors all around the engine that monitor how much air is going into the engine and how much unburnt oxygen is coming out, because that determines how efficient everything has been. And it will make adjustments depending on the readings it gets from all of these sensors in the engine. So what's the key? What's the most important thing when it comes to performance on your car? Well, it's actually the tyres. The grip you have on the road is the biggest single factor determining how well the car performs, how well it handles, how well you can put the power down. So bad tire choices can make a significant dent in the car's performance. So never skimp on tires. Do your research. An all-season tire is effective in all seasons, but it's not going to be good in all seasons. It's just going to be average in all seasons, whereas a summer tire will excel in summer but perform really poorly in winter, and a winter tire conversely will perform very badly in summer but will perform much better in winter. So choosing a tire that's appropriate to the type of road that you experience goes a long way to maximizing performance of your car. And I've done lots of videos on all of these components. So please boot that like button if you found this Everything You Need to Know About Cars video useful. Let me know your thoughts on the subject. Do you have plans for your car? Are you planning to do some upgrades or some modifications to it? If you haven't subscribed to the channel, please do so. We'd love you to stay tuned. And I've lined this video up for you that you should find really interesting. Thanks for watching. See you in this next video.